So I can start the introduction of our next speaker, Theo Bastiaans, who is currently Vice President for Digitalization and Internationalization at the Fernuniversität Hagen here in Germany. But he's about to move to the Netherlands because he's going to be appointed rector at the Open University in the Netherlands from the 1st of January 2019. So congratulations to
that.
Thank
you very much. Thank you.
And now the floor is yours.
Thank you very much for your kind words. Yes, I'm going to switch countries, going to switch university, going to switch position next Friday. So I'm so glad that Will. What could you want more as a new rector, appointed rector? This research about myths, etc., a huge part of it is done at the Open University of the Netherlands. The book that was cited is Peter de Bruycker. He got his PhD from the Open University last year. Paul Kirchner, one of the top 10 leading professors in education technology, has his base for 30 years at the Open University. But that's just little bit of marketing. I'm going to tell you now a little bit about my experience the last 13 years at the Fernuniversität in Hagen. That's a blended learning university, and we are the largest university in Germany. If you look at the student numbers, we have almost 80,000 students. And we are a very traditional university. And this morning at the keynote talk and afterwards at the panel, there was a huge criticism on higher education. Mm-hmm. And I'm going to top that, I think. It was not on purpose, but I'm going to tell you a little bit, and my title is Learn to Teach Best. It's about the world of universities, and especially about university teaching. And the problem we have with university teaching is that it's old-fashioned, it's low quality, and it's demotivational. Teaching. And it's more specific for Europe, for Germany, for Austria, a little bit of the Netherlands, but in general, it's about traditional universities. So universities for vocational education are doing better. I'm just talking about professors who stand behind the podium and just, do their class. Okay. In Western Europe, of course, we have a great system of universities who do research and who teach. And we trust those professors and universities to give our youth the best education. And we trust them also that they support our society with newest innovations from their research, of course. And in the end, universities exist to make our life better, isn't it? I think so. They should make our life better, our society better. Well, there is a huge diversity in research, of course. I'm an educational technologist. I'm not going to tell you which research method you should use, which research you should do, and there are too many disciplines, but I'm going to try to do that for education, for teaching. I think I feel competent enough to tell you a little bit about what you should do nowadays with modern teaching. Oh, my clicker. I need my clicker, of course. Okay, there's something wrong, I already told you, with university teaching and their professors. And I look specifically at the German situation, and title is Learn to Teach Best. Professors have to learn how to teach best, have to learn that. They need to develop themselves as professionals in the field, and they don't. Works. With some exceptions, universities are one of the few institutes in general in modern life that haven't seen radical changes brought by technology. And of course, I don't mean that your students use a laptop or a tablet or an iPhone. No, I mean there's a lack of shift of how things are done. You can do things better, different with new technology. And universities don't use that enough, I think. And society is changing. Things are changing. You heard this morning, too. If we look to the UK and the US, the growing amount of the population living with crippling student debts, it is a threat, a huge threat for the sustainability of our tuition-dependent institutions. Universities are tuition-dependent. And we in Europe see that as not as a big problem. It's not a problem that is now urgent for Germany or Austria. our master, 2-year master in education in Germany costs 1,700 euro for 2 years. So why worry? So it's still very, very cheap. It still is, but maybe in the future, not anymore. One thing will definitely also affect the universities in Europe, and in Germany especially also. There will be a shift towards relevant competency-based programs, and there will be much more aggressive competition for those students. Now, universities are still overrun with students, but that will change. And the education-employment gap will force universities also to think creatively about how to offer the education that students need in a workforce. And companies, they need those students desperately, but they need to have a fitting education. And nowadays, it's not always the case. So transfer of what they learn at the university to those workplaces will be of main importance, I think. And still, if I talk to my colleagues, my professor colleagues, I see them really look like I'm cursing or taking bad words in my mouth. But it's really true. Transfer will be much more important than really theoretical foundations, etc., what we teach exactly nowadays. So for universities, the content of curriculum is less important. You heard that in the debate this morning also. The core differentiator will be how they coordinate useful packages for their students. So it's not about content, but it's about the programs, the offer they make, and how they combine this content and skills and competencies. However, our universities are still very, very top-down. Our students, they have to sit down, they have to listen, take notes, and preferably don't ask questions. Okay. Well, I'm originally from the Netherlands, and I'm going to show you a metaphor. This is how our teaching, in fact, looks like. Look, these are the Netherlands, and our teaching still looks like we are living in very idealistic landscape with windmills and wear wooden shoes. But the reality is, in fact, that we live in an overcrowded country. Live in very convenient and modern apartment buildings, and we smoke weed. Mm-hmm. Yeah, so most professions can point to dramatic changes in the way they work, thanks to technological innovation, but teaching still looks the same, that's the summary. And it looks an awful lot like the days when the professors from now were in high school or at university themselves. And the solution to all this, to this problem, is education. To avoid becoming the stuck and stubborn professor, successful professors, they reflect on their methods, their delivery, the way they connect with their students. And professors, they have to continuously learn new insights, new technology, new assessment methods, etc., etc. But do they? It's the responsibility of an institution, of a board of a university. They should provide professional development programs for all staff, also for professors. First of all, a university should make a deliberate development goal out of it, and not some casual, informal area of interest, because that is professional development at the moment at universities. You can do it or you can, it's voluntarily. So this goal has to be embedded in the institutional policy, because instructional design, pedagogy, it has changed a lot. Learning the newest insights can help professors to become even more appreciated, fun, motivating, and effective, because they think they are. But what has to be in such a professional development plan for university staff, for professors? Well, it's quite obvious, you heard it during this conference more and more. Technology is a topic. It has to be on the list, of course, of relevant expertise. And if you look outside, all these edtech startups, they have been working very, very hard and created a range of add-ons tools to especially create individual learning experiences. And do we really implement that at higher education institutes? I'm not sure. So the competency to select, evaluate, but also work with new ed tech tools is very relevant for professors. And many of them are still not interested in it. Another important topic, of course, new pedagogical approaches. You probably know it, the flipped classroom, crossover learning, etc., etc., all these concepts. But if you go to a professor in philosophy or whatever, he doesn't know that at all. So pedagogical know-how and knowledge about pedagogical insights, about myths, but also the courage to experiment and to try out new formats are of main importance, and you have to push them a little bit, I think. And the last topic, you have to focus on some kind of micro-level instruction. So in the field of didactical patterns, ever heard of it? Those are kind of recipes how to didactically organize your lessons. There's a lot known out there, a lot of research also on it, but it is not used quite a lot. So the expertise to implement, try out, and evaluate very, very useful also. So three things we should put in this development program. And also universities that recruit new faculty and also new professors, they should look at and select at certain criteria. A modern professor must be willing to innovate and try new things in teaching. He must also be willing to explore new technologies. He must be good at organizing and planning a course, online course, in advance. He must be good at having discussions and trying to organize collaborations in class, because that's really, really essential to encourage students to learn. And if you don't want that, then you're not fit to be a professor. But we only look at publications, impact factors, etc., etc. Okay. How do institutions implement a procedure for continuous development of teaching skills for the staff? Well, first of all, a training offer that fits strategic goals of the institution in the field of education. We at the Fernand State are a blended learning university. So we have blended learning as a concept in our strategic goals. And from there on, we develop development plans. Every educational institute needs to make a deliberate choice. And I don't care what they, if they focus on transfer of learning, problem-based learning, competency-based learning, research-based learning. You have to make a choice. And how many of the universities have a deliberate choice in this field? I don't know many. So the training offer has to be also available in time, focus on the strategic choices made, and involve, first of all, a core curriculum, a curriculum that everybody has to know in pedagogy about, for example, this blended learning. Next to this basis, there can also be additional activities and just-in-time offers or changing offers. Well, nowadays I see a lot of one-time workshops, and they're okay at universities to raise awareness or to get things going. But faculty members, they need more. They need a structural approach to their professional development. Secondly, one has to provide rewarding resources. You have to give them time, you have to give them money, you have to give them also that is visible. So status. Okay, so if it's visible to the whole institute, to the whole university, that someone is working hard to innovate his pedagogy and didactics, then you might have a chance that it will work. So what did we do at the Fernuniversität in Hagen? We took a first step. We created an e-teaching certificate. And although we really tried hard, we couldn't make it, it's still on a voluntary basis. We couldn't make it, you know, that everybody had to take it. So we established this e-teaching program. And even if you're ready, it provides our staff, employees, professors with a certificate. So if they leave the Fernuniversität, they are an expert in e-teaching. So what I told you before, we have a core curriculum with the basics, taking only 30 hours of their time. And there's a phase for application, so that what they have learned, that they have to put that in and implement it in their own teaching, 48 hours. And then there's a specialization. Based on what you wish, you can make a choice to focus and become a specialist in a certain field. So the teaching program, it involves training, workshops, hands-on experience, seminars, but very structured, very systematic, online and offline activities. And in the final phase, one has to do an individual teaching project in their own department. So then we and our students have also some value out of it. So the total amount of time for this development program is 100 hours. And you can do it whenever you want. Next to your research and your teaching, you can do it in 1 year, 2 years, 3 years. And the content is pedagogy, didactics, so it's about activating techniques, peer learning, e-assessment, law, of course, new privacy law in the EU. And, of course, a lot of how-to sessions, dealing with technology, organizing your teaching, for example, hybrid classes. We have a lot of hybrid classes nowadays. The results. Well, from the participants' point of view, it was very, very successful. They liked it. Although I was a little bit disappointed, they need more time. So I was hoping that for 100 hours, man, in 1 year, you could invest 100 hours. They can't. They need more time, 2 years, 3 years. Luckily, we see a cultural change in our departments, our research departments and teaching departments. The culture is changing positively, and they are more open to innovation now, also in their curriculum. And even the ministry in Germany has asked us to offer this program to other universities in North Rhine-Westphalia. So it's very, very successful, I can tell. But there was one thing. It was on a voluntary basis. And guess what? No single professor attended the e-teaching certificate. Not one session. They all sent their middle staff, their researchers, and all their teaching support staff. Not one. There's a joke about this professor who is very, very, very angry at his students. He stands up and shouts, "Are there all idiots in this room? And if there are idiots, he or she should stand up." Students, of course, are frightened and quiet. After a while, a young man stands up. The professor then asks that guy if he thinks actually that he is an idiot. And the boy replies, "No, I just didn't want to see you standing there all by yourself." So students can be very forgiving. And now they still accept our way of teaching and treating and coaching our students. But in the long run, if the society keeps changing that fast, they are not going to be that forgiving anymore for a professor. So, summary. Time has come to look at the teaching competencies of professors, implement a professional development plan based on strategic choices. Participation on a voluntary basis does not work. In the Netherlands, for example, they have a new system for professors also. The whole staff at universities, they have to gather some personal development points. So every year you have to collect a certain amount of points, and by the end of the year, with your review, you have to show how much you have done in your professional development. And I think that would be a fantastic idea for every country. And for other Germans and Austrians in the room, this has nothing to do, because I get a lot of complaints that say this has nothing to do with the freedom to teach and to research, because that's the first thing Germans professors always bring up, my colleagues. It's just about taking responsibility as an institution for the quality of your main product, and your main product is teaching your students. That's all I have to say. It was a successful project, but we have to take it to the next level, I think. I have some time for questions, I believe. I gave them 10 minutes or something. That was deliberate. So, are there questions? Well, wait this. Behind you, there's... there.
Yeah. So you said that it needs to be a requirement.
Yeah.
I wonder about an alternative, if you've thought about it. And I assume that they're, as faculty, they get some sort of feedback on how well they're teaching, how successful it is. Maybe the students rate them, maybe there's other kind of ratings. I wondered if those systems are good enough to give them diagnostic feedback, or if they, you know, because you could imagine if there was good diagnostic feedback and they saw, oh my goodness, my students are not performing as well as they might, maybe they would be motivated. I just wondered what you thought about it.
We have a huge evaluation department. Every course is evaluated on materials, activities, all this stuff. The only thing is the results can only be shown to a professor, not to the institution. So we don't see, in fact, because that's a privacy law in Europe, we are not allowed to see this this data. So in general, of course, we do a lot. We have an accreditation system, quality of teaching, etc. But it doesn't involve new pedagogy, innovation, using the latest tools. And I see a lot, of course, in educational technology and maybe a little bit in psychology, it's not a big deal. They are intrinsically motivated. But more in the traditional disciplines, it's really, really hard, and they're just not interested in it. And I think that this morning we talked about the golden age of higher education. It won't happen. Definitely it won't happen, this golden age, because we are not equipped for that, I think, for that. Okay. That's
if none of the professors took it, and yet you say the results are positive, so did the staff they sent were able to make changes that impacted students?
Yeah, the middle staff. So their researchers, their teaching staff. So that's we come up bottom up to the departments, you know. And if there are a lot of them now, 50 of them taking this e-teaching certificate, you know, it comes bottom up. They are motivated to do things, and the professor allows them to do that a little bit, you know. That's the thing. But we really, we pushed it a lot. We made a lot of marketing. We talked to every dean in every school, and they were happy with it. But in the end, no single professor showed up. Okay. That's it then. Well,
thank you very much.
Thank you.
thanks to both of you.